Glasgow Rangers fans have experienced some great nights in European football. Rangers played in the first ever European Cup Winners' Cup final in 1961, losing to Fiorentina over two legs. Again, in the same competition, they lost to Bayern Munich in extra time in 1967. But it was third time lucky in 1972 that gave Rangers supporters their most memorable evening in European football. John Greig led his team in the Nou Camp against Dinamo Moscow. Willie Waddell's team had already beaten the likes of Sporting Lisbon, Torino and Bayern Munich en route. And their class in the first half showed as Rangers took a three-goal lead in front of 30,000 supporters, finally winning 3-2. The events on the final whistle, though, led to the cancellation of the presentation on the pitch and a European ban for Rangers. However, it should never overshadow the feat that Rangers players had achieved that evening. Three men who played in the Nou Camp are here to share their stories with us. My first guest was something of a footballing boy wonder. One of the most versatile players ever to play at Ibrox, Derek Johnstone could play either in defence, midfield or as a striker. Part of a select band that has scored over 200 goals for Rangers, perhaps the most memorable being a winner in the League Cup final against Celtic just days before his 17th birthday. My next guest was an elegant and composed defender who played 778 games in 16 seasons at Ibrox. He made his debut as an 18-year-old against the club he supported as a child, Hearts. In one spell as centre-forward, he scored 11 goals in 12 games. He went on to win 14 major honours whilst at Rangers, but did eventually return to his home club, Hearts. And in 1986, he became the Scottish Player of the Year, 11 years after receiving the same accolade as a Rangers player. Our next guest has been voted the greatest ever Rangers player. John Greig made 857 appearances in 18 seasons. He scored 136 goals, won 16 major honours, won the Scottish treble on three separate occasions. Originally an old-fashioned inside forward and then a defensive wing half. He was twice Scotland's Player of the Year, but a true reflection of John's popularity and service to Rangers can be found at his testimonial in 1978 when an astonishing 65,000 turned up at Ibrox to pay homage. In many respects, John, it was a golden age, wasn't it, for Scottish football, certainly in European terms as well. But domestically, at least, you were just a bit in the shadow of Celtic at that time, weren't you?
I'm glad you brought that up. Celtic had the great run with the Lisbon Lions, and it was coming to an end by the time 72 came along. Mm. It also coincided with the fact that Willie Waddell, one of our ex-players, came back to the club as manager and basically lifted us up from the gutter, so to speak, to compete again at that level. But we have to admit, Celtic had a great side then, and it took a lot of hard work, and eventually we got the players on our side that could overcome that. And basically from then on, for most of the 70s, we had a very successful time.
But what were relationships like between the players, between Celtic and Rangers players, Derek?
Well, I got on well. I mean, I was very friendly with Danny McGrain and with Kenny Dalglish as well. You know, we did things together, you know, like shop openings or whatever. In Glasgow, one can't do it without the other. So if Danny was asked somewhere, they would ask me, and Kenny was the same. But, yeah, we got on well. I mean, we didn't go out drinking and enjoying ourselves together, but we enjoyed each other's company.
Mm. I mean, of course, you played in that 1967 final, didn't you, Sandy? I know you did as well, John. But I just wonder how difficult was that coming. I think it was a week after, wasn't it? It was a week after Celtic had won in Lisbon. How difficult was that for you?
To be honest, I was only an 18-year-old kid, so it was my first ever cup final. So you're playing in the first team, which you're just absolutely delighted with. But to play your first ever cup final, to be a European Cup final, was just a wee bit special. And to be honest, I was too young to take it in. Mm. I was just happy to be there. And I know after the game, I seen a video of that game about a year ago, and we absolutely wiped the floor with Bayern, but we couldn't score the goal. And I remember that while I wasn't too unhappy at the end of the game, I know that John and some of the older players were a wee bit, they took it really, really bad. But to be honest, I was just happy to play there. And I didn't understand the consequences, the Celtic winning a European trophy and us not. And that's when we did get the chance to win it in 72. It was that wee bit sweeter to, if you like, level it up.
Mm. I mean, did you feel under pressure to deliver something, John?
Yeah, I was really disappointed in 67 because we were unlucky enough to play Bayern Munich in the final in Germany, in Nuremberg. Yeah. And I'll never forget, the dressing room was a concrete, big concrete thing. It was huge. And I walked into the dressing room. I don't know if he wasn't disappointed, but I certainly was. And I slung this box with my medal right against every wall. And the little trainer, who was the second team trainer, who was there, he came up to me in the team bus going back to the hotel, and he says, "Listen, son, you may want to keep that till for the future and look back on it, you know, because you're not playing a European final very often." So, to answer your question, yeah, by the time we got to Barcelona in 72, I felt, well, I had been a young player, although I just joined the club when we played Fiorentina in 60-61. We'd lost against Bayern Munich in 67, and by this time I really knew you didn't get many European finals. So I thought Barcelona could possibly be, well, certainly my last throw at the dice, and I felt it was one we had to win. Mm. We just had to win for the club and for the supporters as well, as well as for ourselves.
I mean, you all spent a long, long period at Rangers. Was neither of you two were Rangers supporters as boys?
No, we were both Hearts supporters.
Both Hearts fans.
I used to go with my dad, because I used to stay only 50 yards from Tynecastle. So when I was a kid, my dad was a big Hearts supporter. He used to go over and just stand behind the goals, get a lift over in the turnstiles in these days. In fact, the first time I ever seen Rangers, it was a Rangers-Hearts game. It was 45,000, and I got lifted over the turnstiles with my brother. But in these days, that was to collect the beer bottles and put them in a sack, and used to get a penny a beer bottle. But that was the first time I ever really seen Rangers play.
So how did you feel, John, when Rangers actually came along for you at first?
Well, I was a late baby in my family, because I had three older brothers and two older sisters, and my three older brothers were all Hearts supporters. So obviously, living in Edinburgh, I was growing up in Edinburgh, a Hearts family. But I'd played at Tynecastle on two or three occasions for the Edinburgh schoolboys and things. And I was a small ball playing inside forward in those days, which a lot of people won't believe. But the Hearts actually told me I was too small. I was only about 5'3", 5'4". And in fact, I'd been likened to the famous Bobby Johnstone that played with the Hibernian team at the time. We went to Manchester City. And I hated that, because I hated the Hibs. And they told me I was too small. And the Rangers scout actually, he did something. He went to where all my brothers and sisters were working, and watched them coming out of the work, and found out who they were, and saw, had a look at the size of them, and thought, well, he'll grow. And Rangers signed me. And then from that day, I never looked back.
Tell me about Willie Waddell. What was he like as a man? Could he be a bit of a grouch, a bit sour?
Yeah, I think if you were doing the right things, he was great to you. I mean, if you did something to annoy him, well, he told you about it. He could be like that. He always had his glasses just below his eyes. Never looked at you. He always looked over them at you, his glasses. And he had a great thing. I remember going up to get my very first contract. And you go into the office and you knock at the door, and the little light goes, "Enter." So you walk in, and he's actually sitting above you. You're there and you're sitting down, and he's looking down on you. All psychological. And he would say to me, I would already been told by the likes of John, when you're going up there, ask for this and ask for that.
Don't accept. You must have been a good prospect, by the way, because we ought to stand.
Yeah.
We never got to sit.
I was just 17, remember. So I've gone in there. So I know what John's told me to ask for and everything else. So I'm sitting there. And he said, first thing he said to me, "How's the family?" I went, "Oh, well, fine, Mr. Waddell. Yes, they're doing well. Yeah, that's good to see you. You've settled in very well here." He says, "But I've been having words with Jock, and there's you and Derek Parlian in the team. Maybe you can't afford to have two of you. One of you is going to have to go." So right away, I could feel myself shaking. He's like, "No." He says, "I like you." He says, "I'll tell you what I'll do. See the money you've had for the last 2 years. You sign this 2-year contract for exactly the same money, and I'll take you on." I went, "Thanks, boss." So I signed it. So I come out, and John said, "Did you get everything you were looking for?" I went, "Thanks, John, you were a big help." I was too frightened to say to him that I was conned into it, you know, by Mr. Waddell. That's what he was like.
What was the story about the financial director locking himself in the safe?
Willie Waddell was through and through a Rangers man, you know, and we had this accountant, and he was like John Cleese, a double of John Cleese, and he was a very nervous lad. And Willie Waddell was always wondering how much money we had in the bank, the club had in the bank, and then what the bank rate was, and could we save a bit here, and could we earn a bit more there. And he gave this guy a real hard time. So it got to the stage where one day he roared for him. and Frank was so nervous that nobody could find him. He locked himself in the walk-in safe. and then when he heard Mr. Waddell going for his lunch, he went home and never came back. He resigned.
Yeah. But obviously he knew the game, didn't he? I mean, Derek, for a start, yeah. He gave you your chance, didn't he? I mean, do you remember scoring as a 16-year-old in that?
Yeah, well, final? I mean, it doesn't matter.
You'll never forget it, would you?
No, not at all. I mean, it doesn't matter where you go in the world. You know, the older ones that are Rangers fans will always bring that up. They'll always say, I was there that day you scored. So far there was 357,000 at Hampden that day. There's so many people say that to me. But yeah, I can always remember, I mean, I was in the squad, and I can remember on the Friday after training. In these days, you didn't go away for a couple of days. You just turned up the next day, then you got the bus at Ibrox and went to Hampden for the game. And he pulled me into the boot room, myself and Willie Waddell and Jock Wallace, and they handed me half a dozen tickets and said, look, take them home for your family for the game tomorrow. I went, oh, thanks very much, boss. He said, by the way, you're playing. He said, so get a good night's sleep. I mean, how on earth are you going to get a good night's sleep? I was 16 and a half years of age, knowing that you were going to play. And I couldn't tell him. He says, just keep it quiet. So I've gone home in the train, and obviously I've told my family that was playing. So they all came through. They managed actually to get a 50-seater bus through with six tickets. And they all came. They just stood outside Hampden, all the family and friends in the street and everything else. And, of course, the game turned out well. I always remember getting the paper that morning, and as usual, all the other captains of the team in the old First Division then, they actually said who was going to win the cup. Rangers hadn't won anything for 3 or 4 years. No, they hadn't won a trophy.
4 years, man.
So they'd asked every captain, you know, who's going to win it today? And I think everybody bar one said Celtic would win it. And I think that spurred us on as well, things like that. And as it happened in the 42nd minute after a ball from Willie Johnson, I went in between Jim Craig and Billy McNeil and headed the ball into the bottom left-hand corner. As you know, I forget all about it.
But that was the difference in the game then, Jeff. I mean, he was 16. And the manager took the chance and put him in. If you're good enough, you're old enough. It'd be very difficult to do that nowadays because all the teams have so many foreign players at their disposal and big squads and everything. But the gaffer put a 16-year-old boy in and he scored the winning goal. Never forget it. You can see he's forgot everything about the goal, but he'll live with the rest of his life.
When it comes to the cup run, Sandy, by now, are you an overlapping fullback? Because you had been being played as a pretty successful centre forward, hadn't you?
Basically, when I first came into the team, I started as a midfield player. And then we had a wee problem at centre forward. And believe it or not, Alec Ferguson was at the club. So it was vying between me and Fergie to be a centre forward. And I thought I'd done reasonably well. I scored, I think, 11 goals in 12 games or something like that.
Whatever happened to him?
he disappeared.
The face of the earth.
But anyway, so myself and Fergie were kind of vying for the position. But what Rangers did then is they went out and spent £100,000, which was a huge amount of money, and bought Colin Steen. So me and Fergie got kind of dropped. Fergie left the club, but I got shifted back and basically developed into a fullback. So I became an overlapping fullback.
Mm. One of the first of that type, really, were you?
Well, that's when the game was starting to change tactically as well. What they would call it is a wing-back now. Mm. Myself and Danny McGrain were coming on the scene and that was the start of overlapping fullbacks.
Mm. Non-tackling, overlapping fullback.
Sorry, highly skilled.
Highly skilled, overlapping non-tackling. Fullback. That's the way he likes to class it.
Was Jock Wallace at the club by then?
Oh, yeah. Jock came in... when did Jock
70.
Come?
1970.
Jock came... Willie Waddell brought Jock to the club.
Mm. What was his influence like?
Jock was like a sergeant major. I mean, he'd been in the, I think it was at KOSB in Korea. Jock was a real hard. He believed that even though you weren't maybe not as good as the team you were playing against, you would run them off the field with your fitness, because he would give us the training he gave us. We'd never experienced anything like it in our life before. The old Ibrox with the huge terraces, we used to run up and down there for 40 minutes non-stop. You couldn't walk or anything. Our fitness was unbelievable. Mm. And to be fair, he must have given me at least 2 or 3 years on to the end of my career with the build-up of the fitness that he gave us. But a real hard man, Jock,
He was a real Rangers man.
Real
as well.
Rangers man. Yeah.
He used to tell the stories when he was in Korea and would be engaged in fighting, and it had stopped for about an hour, and it was a Saturday afternoon. He would send the private up with an antenna to the top of one of the trees to listen to the game, the BBC overseas, to hear about the Rangers. You know, and he would keep the boy up the tree until he found out how Rangers were getting on. Even in the jungle, that's how much a Rangers man he was. And I think he told us one day, as we were leaving the army, he got a letter from his best pal, and he opened up. He says, "Jock, it's been marvellous working with you. You've been brilliant." He says, "One day you will be the manager of Rangers." And he always kept that. He always kept that in his
head. He actually thought that he was trying to repay the club for a little bit, because he was a goalkeeper and the manager at Berwick Rangers in probably the worst game in the history of our club when they beat us. And he never let us
forget about it anyway.
But he certainly did a good job for the club when he came to us. I mean, he was really a hard man approach, you know, and all the players were superbly fit.
I remember the first, he came in the pre-season, and our first pre-season training, he took everybody out in the track, and there was 46 players, full-time players, and he did what we used to get every Tuesday thereafter. It was called a 40 minutes. It was non-stop running, lifts up in the terrace and things like that. And I think at the end of it, there was only six of the players left. There were young kids were over the side of the track being sick. Some of the kids were getting oxygen. The training was ferocious. And we got that, as John said, every Tuesday if we didn't have a midweek game.
He fooled us a wee bit because he started to introduce a ball.
That was the first question. What is this?
Remember that? Willie Henderson was a great winger, and Willie was still at the club at the time. We were running, getting this 40 minutes, and Wee Willie was a big fan of this 40 minutes running. And I remember we were running, and Wee Willie always tried to get up the front because he could get dragged along. And I remember he was going like that, and he was running, and he went, "Oh, to hell with this," and he just ran right up the tunnel, ordered the taxi, and went home.
That was the last we've seen him.
Basically, near the end of his career, practically, just about. But we had some good times with Jock. I mean, Jock was a player's man as well. He liked the players to
good night,
to enjoy himself and have a drink with the players and things like that.
Remember the day at training? We were struggling to score goals, maybe about a two-month period. And he said, "Look, we're having a wee game, and I don't care if you're a yard out from the goal. Put it in the back of the net. Get used to putting the ball in the net, right, Gaffrey? So we'll play the game." So one of the players, who I shall not name, but let's say it was Alfie Conn. Alfie ran through, and Peter McCloy came out, and Alfie rounded him. And he could have stuck it in the net, but he didn't. He held on to it. He came back and tried to beat him again. And eventually, big Peter smothered the ball. And Jock shouted to him, "What have I told you?" And Alfie went, "It's only a friendly game." Well, he stopped the game, Jock, and he went over to Alfie. And with one hand, he picked him up off the ground. And he had the left hand ready to hit him before about four or five people jumped on the top of him. And to be fair, I mean, Alfie just went white. He was sent over to Ibrox. And nothing was ever said again, apart from Alfie leaving about 3 weeks later to go to Spurs. And that was it. Yeah. He was so passionate, you know, about the club. And if people didn't do what they were told, he became a hard man.
Mm. How important was it, John, to, you know, to win some silverware? Bearing in mind, you know, that not long before we've had the Ibrox disaster, was that a motivational, was that an inspirational thing as you went through the rounds of the
No, I wouldn't say that was a... That was. I would think, personally, I just always felt that when you played for a club like Rangers in the Scottish League, you expected to win trophies. I mean, I was disappointed that we didn't win the treble every year. I know it's impossible, but I was really disappointed, because playing for such a great club, who usually had some great players and a fantastic support at our back, you couldn't help but feel confident in going out and winning. But that period of time, around just about the 70s, when Derek started that off with the League Cup, was a very, very important time for us, because we came out of that wilderness where we had been when Celtic had been winning. And we had the nucleus here of a very good side, and which became a very experienced side, and we started to win the trophies then. It's like, in Scotland, for most of the time, it's Rangers and Celtic, although there was a brief episode not long after that, in the late 70s, where Aberdeen, under the managerialship of Alec Ferguson, and Dundee United with Jim McLean, had a little bit of a fling, but generally speaking, it's always been Rangers and Celtic. Mm-hmm. So it's been the rivalry is there all the time, whether you're winning or not.
Certainly didn't have it easy, did you? I mean, you know, looking at the first round, you've gone to Rennes, or you played Rennes over the two rounds. I think their manager was less than impressed that you said you were anti-football.
Yeah.
why was that?
I think, well, that season we didn't start too well in the league. So we were looking for our form, if you like. I think we had got beaten the Saturday that he had come to watch us prior to going over there. So we hadn't been, if you like, top of our game. And basically we went out there and just defended. And these days, the way the European Cup was and the Cup Winners' Cup was that you went over there and you held on to what you can get. So if you could come away with just losing one goal, you were quite happy because you knew at Ibrox or at home you were going to have the huge amount of the game and you were going to do your business at home. So we went into that game and, as I say, we weren't playing that well, but we got a reasonably good result. And when we got them back at Ibrox, we weren't quite convincing.
In Europe, you know, we had good defenders in Europe. We didn't do anything that season. We didn't win anything. The season we won the Cup Winners' Cup. Domestically, we won nothing. You know, it was all seemed to be the eggs were all put in one basket.
But part of that is, I think, is because we had such a good run in the Cup. And these days, it wasn't a charter. I mean, the players now, they go, they come and their bus is dropped off. They're into a charter plane and they're right there. I mean, we used to have to get a scheduled flight from Glasgow down to London, then get another flight for London to wherever we were playing. In fact, I remember when we were playing the Sport in Lisbon, we got the flight down to London, and I think there was fog, and then we had to wait about in the airport, and then no flights were taken off. We had to stay in London and then get the flight out in the morning, and we didn't arrive in Lisbon until something like 24 hours before the game. So it was totally different. And then you didn't play on a Sunday. You came back. You were not getting back till maybe Thursday night. And then you came in the morning, did a wee bit of training, and then you played the Saturday. So it did have an effect on you on a Saturday. Mm. And because we had such a long run, then I think it had an adverse effect in the league. Those are the days of our lives.
Those are the days of our lives. John, I mean, Sandy mentioned that Lisbon trip. Well, you thought you were out, weren't you?
Yeah.
Lost a penalty shootout.
Yeah, we
it's an amazing story.
It was a terrible night that night because Ronnie McKinnon, who's our international central defender, he got this horrendous tackle from a. From
you remember who his name was? The big center.
Gisaldi, I think it was. Yeah. And he had this terrible tackle on Ronnie McKinnon. And big Ronnie was the type of guy that would go in the bath at night time after a game, and he had a little scratch in his knee, and if the hot water went, he would go. he'd be really struggling. But this night, his leg was lying at all angles, and he just went. My leg's broken. Yeah. Not a murmur. And the trainer came on, they took him away, and the game finished at the after extra time, and the penalty kick situation took place, and I was to go last of the five. Everybody missed, including David Smith, who missed twice.
Twice.
He got to retake it and missed it again, so I didn't take it, we just walked off. And we were in the showers, and we thought we were out of the competition. And it was a guy from John Fagreeve, a reporter with the Daily Mail, came along. He was a very, very good friend of Willie Waddell's, and he said to Willie Waddell, "Look," he says, "I've had a quick look at the handbooks. There wasn't all these delegates snivelling round about the games in those days." And he says, "I think the way this reads, you're true. You shouldn't have taken penalty kicks."
Because you'd won the first leg 3-2, but lost the second leg 4-3 after extra time.
Yeah, but the goals in extra time counted double.
It was 3-2 after 90 minutes, and then it went 4-3, 1-1 in extra time. Yeah. So the mistake was that they didn't know that the away goal in extra time counted. So technically, we were through an away goal in these days, and that's where they made the mistake.
So we came off the park feeling we were out, and we didn't really get it confirmed to the next day that we were still in. But that was one of the breaks we had in the Cup.
That was the only time I ever felt frightened if I was picked to go. And I was on the bench when that happened, and Jock said to Davy Smith and I, "Get warmed up," because obviously Ronnie was coming off. And for the first time, and probably only time, I said, "I hope it's not me that's going on." And as it happened, he went for the experience. Dave Smith went on and played a bit. It was another night because I remember it was November the 3rd that game was played. And these games were played at 9 or 10 o'clock at night in Lisbon. And the game, because it was an extra time and penalties and all the hullabaloo, it went into midnight into the next day, and it was my 18th birthday the next day on November the 4th. That's why I remember that Sporting Lisbon game.
Mm-hmm. I remember it coming off the park, and their goalie is getting cheered round with all the players, and the supporters are all fantastic reception he's getting, and we're all trooping into the dressing room absolutely depressed because you've just been knocked out. And as John said, John Fairbury's coming in and then rushing away to the...
Our fans, we met someone at the airport, they thought we were out. They didn't know. They're already out the ground. So they didn't really know until maybe an hour or 2 hours later, maybe even the next morning when they flew home.
Mm-hmm. That's an astonishing story, isn't it? You must have thought, I know it's a cliche, but you must have thought your name's on the cup this season.
Oh, you started to believe that, yeah. Mm-hmm. Started to believe that.
Until we got drawn against
Torino the next
Torino, time. Which was always, the Italian team was always a really difficult game with them. And then after that, Bayern Munich.
There was a good laugh about that. But Willie Waddell was always meticulous in his preparations for these games. And he would sit us all down the night before the game and he would hold up a photograph and say, this is a goalkeeper. He's not very good at cross balls, but...
He's good in the air.
He'll dive to his left if it's a penalty, things like this. And he picked up this one and he says, John, this is a guy called Claudio Sala, number 10. He's the latest Italian wonder boy. I want you to put him out of the game. And I says, for the season or for today? He says, come on. But he was like that. He was meticulous in the preparation. I mean, a team talk the night before a match used to last about an hour and a half. And he told us all about these things, you know, about which way the goalkeeper would dive now. But the Torino game, we got by that. But I think what we all really thought was we got Bayern Munich in the semi-final. And Bayern Munich was a great side at that time with Beckenbauer and Müller and all the rest of them. Mm. And what I think I felt we had to protect ourselves from was after beating Bayern Munich, we didn't think that was a final win. You know, we didn't think we'd won the cup because we drew this Russian team.
Everybody said the semi-final should have been the final.
Yeah,
and it was built up with that in the Scottish papers. You know, whoever wins this game will be the winners. Mm. And that's what John's saying. You couldn't do that.
And by now, you're playing centre half. By now, aren't you? You didn't against Torino. You played centre half, didn't you?
It's funny because
I've been found out as a
centre forward. Yes, but that's the great thing about being able to play in various positions. You had a chance of playing again. But the weirdest one was against Bayern Munich in the first game over in the Olympic Stadium because Willie Waddell took me aside. He said, I've got a role for you today. He says, I want you to pick up Uli Hoeneß, who was the midfield man. He's now the general manager, still is, of Bayern Munich.
Because of your pace.
My pace, I had to live with him. He says, I don't care if you don't touch the ball, as long as he doesn't touch the ball, because they can't afford to be without him, we can afford to be without you. So it would be 10 against 10. But that was my job, just to follow him around the pitch and not let him set up any chances.
Was that the same night? We played them two or three times, Bayern Munich. But was that the same night that in the first 20 minutes, every one of their outfield players had a shot at goals?
You know how when you look back in your career and you get a real going over and you always remember that? Well, that is the biggest going over I've ever had in a Rangers team. And players will talk and say, we never got out of half. We hardly got out of the 18-yard box for the first half. I mean, they were a fantastic team, and I had about six or seven people that would players that would then go in and play in the World Cup in 74. Yeah. And we just actually defended for for our lives. And I think we came in at half-time only 1-0 down. And as John said, every player in our team had a shot at goals. We hardly got outside our 18-yard box. The second half started, and what happened is that one thing we did have is a superb fitness, as we talked about with Joke Wallace, and basically they shot their bolt. And then we started to come more and more in the game, and then we got a goal, which was basically a deflection, but it was going into Steeney, but the boy put it in the net. And we actually finished the game
stronger better,
and put them under pressure. But I think we still realised it was going to be a hell of a...
But the great thing we did have, Sandy, we defended well, but we had two men up front. You could hit the ball anywhere in the park and they would chase it. And Willie Johnson and Colin Steen, they were absolutely amazing. Away from home, when you needed to try and get a goal, and inevitably these two got it for us.
But another secret there, which we look back on now, Derek, was that it was a great team spirit in that team, Jeff. They were all Scotsmen to start with, so we all spoke the same language. Which is unusual nowadays.
Some of you Edinburgh boys spoke a bit funny for me.
But there was a tremendous team spirit amongst the lads, you know, and there were good professionals and we could handle situations. And that's why we got through that one in Munich.
Because you'd drawn the away leg and then the home leg. We'll come to your goal in a minute, Sandy. But you know, but there are eight... What were European nights like at Ibrox, 80,000 people there.
Well, it's fabulous. It's a fabulous night. Yeah, it was. That was one I missed because I got injured a couple of weeks earlier in the semi-final of the Scottish Cup. But and I had to sit and watch it, which was even worse than being in the field. But it was great. I mean, 80,000 people. I mean, it was magnificent.
See, that night we won 2-0 in Glasgow and 80,000 at Ibrox. There was 80,000 at Parkhead because Celtic were playing.
Who spent those or was it?
No, it was
like
Milan, one of the Milan teams.
Milan.
And the two clubs were in the semi final, and there was two semi finals in the same city, and they had to go to extra time because I remember when we came in after we beat Bayern, sitting watching the game, and they were going through the penalties.
You wouldn't get away with that nowadays because the police wouldn't let you play two games in one city.
160,000 people at football.
Unbelievable!
In one night.
Incredible!
Yeah. And of course. Sandy, you got the goal that set you on the way.
Ah, yeah.
It was a missed kick.
You're not showing it, so it's a fantastic shot. It beat Seth Meyer in the top corner.
It never hit the back of the net. By the way, it was an important one.
Was that not the first time we'd played in an all-blue strip? Remember we had blue shorts as well that night?
Yeah.
It was an all-blue strip, first time ever that Rangers had won that.
The thing I remember that with that game, apart from the result, was the way that Seth Meyer in goal, international goalkeeper and Franz Beckenbauer, gave each other a terrible roasting.
They were arguing.
Arguing like anything because he should have been coming for the ball or something. Beckenbauer, I've never seen players of that calibre doing that before.
But in fairness, we got off to a great start, but we actually played brilliant.
Yeah.
We thoroughly deserved to beat them 2-0.
Because the man that took over from John, Derek Parlin, scored as well. He got the second goal. Yeah.
But we totally dominated the game. Totally dominated the game against a team of their quality. And to be honest, it turned out that was one of our easiest games in the competition.
But Jock was clever. Did he not put Colin Jackson, who was a centre-half, on Beckenbauer to stop him at the back, pinging the ball's front? Colin Jackson actually played up and marked him in his own half, you know, which was never heard of before.
I can't remember that.
I can't remember that. Is that the same game?
See, you two are in your 80s. That's the difference.
I was watching that. I can't remember that. I just thought Bomber was out of position.
No, Bomber was out of position again.
So after that semi-final, I know that Franz Beckenbauer said that he was convinced you were going to go on and win it, but were you all convinced that you'd win it now?
I think we were. I think the semi-final was going to be the big one for us, and I think we all realised, although we never said it, you know, if we can get through the big one in the semi-final, then we would be favourites. You know, but you didn't take anything for granted. But we had the feeling that we could go on and win it. It certainly wasn't impossible, that's for sure.
Plus, when you see the quality of the teams we had taken out, you know, particularly Sporting Lisbon, Turin and Bayern Munich, then if you can take teams like that and beat them, then you knew you had a really, really good chance. And in these days, when we went to the final against the Moscow Dynamo, that was the old Iron Curtain. You know, I mean, we take for granted you can get television pictures, you can travel and that. It's so difficult in these days to get behind the Iron Curtain. And I don't know, even Jock, I think Jock got to go and see them once. Because I remember finding all his old notes.
You got hassled a lot getting there, didn't you?
But it was so difficult to just to even travel into Russia in these days. So I think we knew it was going to be a hard game. And the only thing that I think, from my point of view, is that if we got ahead of ourselves and took it for granted. But I don't think we did that. Mm.
And of course you played, you know, sporting a beard, which you weren't a big fan of. But tell us the story, John.
It was the morning of the match before Sporting Lisbon in Glasgow, and I had this altercation with a park bench, which we were doing our warm-up, and smashed the bench. And I took my local doctor and got 9 stitches in my chin. And we in those days had to be clean shaven and collar and tie, even for training. So after the game, the press were saying to me, "Why, you know, shaved and that?" And I said, "Well, I had an accident this morning, got 9 stitches. Must be a lucky woman. I'm going to keep this heavy growth, a beard, until we get put at the competition." So by the time we got to Barcelona, I had this huge beard. And, I hated it, but I got £100 for shaving it off after the game, so it wasn't too bad.
And of course, the fans would be talked about after the game, Derek, but, you know, I mean, there was something like 16,000 there, you know, hundreds of charter flights, hundreds of coaches. You had a phenomenal amount of support.
Yeah, it was incredible. What was there, 32,000 at the game? Right. I think they were talking about 25,000 at least, right, Rangers fans at the game. And, you know, when you go to Spain, even on holiday, you know, you always partake of the local brew. And that was a problem for the majority of them with the sunshine and everything else. But they were going over there because they know, they knew. I think the majority of them that went to that game had probably been at the other two finals and were bitterly, bitterly disappointed. So, as John said earlier, third time lucky, you know, so they were all there. And it was just a fantastic day. I mean, we were training and you can see them all in the streets. All you saw was red, white and blue all over the place. I think the locals were frightened to turn out. They were frightened of these Scotsmen with kilts on and everything else, dancing about the streets drunk.
But one of the best laughs was when you got back, we got back to, after the game, we came to Ibrox and obviously we went down around Ibrox with the trophy. And it wasn't me, but I remember one of the lads telling the story that he bumped into the lad coming off the, because some of the charter flights were coming into the airport when we were coming back, bumping into one of the lads, and he says, "Oh, great, fantastic, but I've made a right faux pas." He says, "How what?" "My car's back there. He had got put on a charter to get back and go to it."
He drove over. Manchester Airport arrived back. Because there was a problems after the game, they just threw people on the charters the next morning anywhere back to the UK. And the guy was drunk and he ended up in Manchester. And the policeman tried to move him and he says, "Where am I?" He says, "Manchester." He says, "What?" He says, "Did you get the wrong plane?" He says, "The wrong plane." He says, "I went by car to Barcelona." But going to the game that night, I personally felt within 2-3 miles from the stadium, it was all Rangers supporters we could see. It was all, as Derek says, all this massive...
And these days, the Russians, didn't they travel? No, I mean, they hardly got the team out of the country, never mind.
And I just felt when I got for the team bus to walk into that stadium, we can't lose tonight. We can't lose for their sake, never mind for our own sake. We just can't lose this game. And to be honest, there was only one set of supporters there. And even after all this time, I still blame the Spanish police for the way they handled it. Because there was no, they weren't troublemakers, the people that come on the park. They were just basically celebrating. Although they came on 2 or 3 times, because it was now 3-2 and they were getting a bit concerned, as we all were. But I just think they handled it terribly and... It put us out of Europe for a year after that.
But it was a special day in the sense that Colin Jackson, who would have played in the final, he had an injury. And I think he got up until the morning of the game.
He went over his ankle, fitness tested.
He went over it again, so he was ruled out. So, as usual, you go to your bed in the afternoon before these big games, just to rest, just to get off your feet. And I had a knock on the door, and of course it was Jock and Willie Waddell again, who came in and told me that I was playing. So I wouldn't have played, you know, if Colin was fit. So I was eternally grateful. But I felt sorry for Colin, because it was a big, big moment. But it just turned out fantastic. I was back in defence of that. But the great thing about that was I was probably playing alongside, for me, I thought the man of the match in Dave Smith. He was just so good a player to play alongside. He talked you through the game. You know, he would say to me, "Look, if the ball's in the air, just go and attack it. Because if he wins it, I'm at your back. If the ball's played to his feet, try and get in front of him and take it away from him. If he beats you, I'm at your back." And that's the way he spoke to you the whole game. He spoke to me and talked me through it. And I think watching the game again, the amount of times that Dave Smith and I got forward, well, he set up two of the goals running forward. I've had 2 shots at the goal as a centre-half as
they
well.
He played a very, like say, it was like 4-3-3 with a withdrawn centre-forward, if you like. So they had two wingers who were exceptionally quick. So I was the right back, so I would be out wide marking him. Billy Masson's the left back, was out wide. And the people that got most of the ball were yourself and Davy Smith. And when you look at the game, the two of you were absolutely brilliant. The centre-forward never put any pressure, so they got a lot of time on the ball. And the two of them were good users of the ball. So, as you say, you two were absolutely brilliant that night.
I think Davy Smith's quite a story as well, isn't it? Because he broke his leg, hadn't he, twice, not so long before. So that's an amazing comeback.
What amazed me about Davy as well, if the centre-forward got the better of him and had a shot, he would be the first to go over and say, "Well done, I wasn't expecting you to do that." And I would look at him and say, "What are you doing, man?" But that's how Davy was. He was so cool under pressure, Davy. He was a fantastic man to play alongside.
So you've been 3-0 up, and as you said, John, they've got back to 3-2. Those last few minutes must have been a little bit worrying.
Oh, I remember running to Willie Johnstone when he scored the third goal, because Willie played in...
against Bayern Munich in 67 along with Sandy and I. And I said to him, that's 3-0, Bud. Bud was his nickname. I says, we can't lose this one now. Well, about 15, 20 minutes later, I was saying to myself, they better blow that whistle or we're struggling. And of course, the fans felt the same thing, because every time he blew a whistle, he blew his whistle for a free kick or something, they would start to try and come on the field. And I was giving them a bit of stick. I couldn't, I think it was his Spanish. I was giving them a bit of Spanish anyway and telling them it was time up.
Okay.
He didn't seem to understand it because he kept playing. But we were hanging on at the end. But, you know, after, I think it was an anti-climax as well, Jeff, because after Fiorentina, after Bayern Munich, after Celtic winning in Lisbon and being able to celebrate, our supporters had been through a lot over the years. They'd watched other teams having success. And to this day, I still feel for them that they couldn't see the cup getting presented. A lot of people never saw that cup. Mm-hmm. A lot of our supporters never even seen the
Because the you were
cup.
Presented with it.
Well, basically what happened was when I was in the dressing room, the guy came along and said to Willie Waddell, you and your captain, come with me. And they took us along these mazy tunnels in the new camp, to this little room. And there was these UEFA officials sitting there, and the guy more or less just says, Cup Winners' Cup 1972, Rangers, here, on you go. Get out of here as quick as you can, because there was still trouble going on. And I felt sorry for all the lads were... Yeah.
I can remember sitting in the bath. We were all in the bath when you came in. You came out and you threw the cup in the bath. You know, yeah. It was an anti-climax.
You know, because...
Wouldn't allowed to go around
but
the pitch.
But you have to understand, Jeff, in Scotland at that time, if you played a final, whether Rangers or Celtic at Hampden, you didn't get an opportunity to do a lap of honour. That didn't happen. Basically, the police didn't allow it. So a European game was the only chance that you had a chance to, if you like, enjoy and celebrate with the supporters. And basically because of the Spanish police, that we were denied that. Mm. And you didn't even have the chance to celebrate going up and getting the cup and getting your medal and everything like that. So in many ways, that was a big anticlimax.
So when did you get your medals?
I can't remember now. We didn't get our medals. They were given in a box. Yeah. And in the first game of the season at Ibrox, we got them presented on the pitch.
Aye. We didn't see them for three months, and then the first game. In front of the fans, which was good, because that was the first time we'd seen them. So it was lovely to get, and the fans loved it as well, of course. Mm. Yeah.
Were you aware of just how much trouble there had been the batting charges and the bottles?
The big thing was trying to get off the park, because our supporters came on, and they were wanting to take your jersey, your strip, your pants, because they wanted souvenirs, and they were just over-celebrating. And it was a battle, because in the new camp, it's one of them that you didn't go up a tunnel, you have to go down steps, like a tunnel down the way. And it was just fighting to try and get off and keep... And, of course, you're tired. You try to keep the supporters away
and you want to get tired down. And naked.
Aye. running down the stairs.
I started that game with the stress fracture. And when the guys come in at the end, as I've got a picture in the house, the guy picked me up, and as he let me down, his pal jumped up in the air and come down on my sore foot. And I didn't realise at the time, it was only a few weeks later, I went for an X-ray, and I had 2 stress fractures, one on either side of my foot, and I missed the start of next season. Now, I gave it a few injuries in my time, but this was one of my own supporters put me to the game for about 2 months at the start of the following season. He jumped on my foot. They were so enthusiastic, it was unbelievable. Mm.
It was a great feeling for them, not only for yourselves, but you're right for them, especially the lads that had lost the 2 previous ones. I mean, it was my first one, not my first final, because I'd played in 3 finals before that. Obviously, the League Cup, the Scottish Cup against Celtic, the one we drew them, I had the replay, and this was the fourth one. But you really felt for the fans, and you can see it in their face that they absolutely loved it. It was for them that we won it.
Yeah, I mean, amazing scenes, but of course... The problem was you then got banned. You weren't able to defend your title the next year. Did you think that was unfair, John?
Yeah, I felt we actually got the penalty. We got a heavy fine, 2 years suspension. Mm. And Willie Waddell had gone to UEFA and protested about it. And he got the fine cut in half, I think it was at the time. But we still got the year suspension.
But did we not get a 2-year ban?
We got cut to 1 year. He got it cut to 1 year, that was it. Which was good, in as much that
A club like ours has got to play in Europe.
One of the amazing things about that final, you know, was that it wasn't televised live, was it, Sandy?
No.
So have you all got your copies of it from somewhere?
Got a copy, yeah. But the reason it wasn't televised is that the home internationals were on, and Scotland were playing Wales that night, and the SFA didn't give it permission. So they put it on a delayed transmission.
Delayed transmission.
So it came on at 12 o'clock at night. So there was a lot of Rangers supporters that didn't travel over, that basically went away, didn't want to hear anything, and then watched the delayed transmission at 12 o'clock at night. You know.
And obviously it's helped contribute, John, to the fact that you were voted Rangers' greatest ever player. I mean, when you think of the players that they've had at that club, that's some accolade, isn't it?
Yeah, it is, and I fully appreciate it, although I find it a bit embarrassing because when I first joined the club, I was conscious of the great players that had been in the club before I had arrived at it. And when I became the captain, even more so with the past captains in the club. And I've always felt it's been a great honour and a privilege to play for the club I've been for a long time. And to me, that was enough. This was unbelievable. At first, I thought it was a joke because I didn't think it was a... I couldn't believe what they were doing, and then supporters would come up and say to me, I'm voting for you, and you start to get involved, and I think, well, if it means that much to them, then obviously...
But you're being a wee bit modest in yourself.
I know that, but
what you have to understand is that was for what you were to the club, what you achieved with the club, and what you imparted to the rest of the players, as well as your playing ability. So you are being a wee bit modest.
Well, that's kind of you to say that. I'll pay you later.
I'll get half your fee.
That's an incredible story, isn't it? You know, a side who thought they were out of the Cup Winners' Cup have gone on to beat some of the best teams in Europe and won the trophy. It's absolutely fantastic. And John, Sandy, Derek, thanks very much for sharing those memories. I enjoyed it very much.
Thank you. Pleasure.